Now, to break down fatty acids, we go through a process called beta-oxidation. So I want to step us through that. The enzymes in the enzymes for beta-oxidation are found in mitochondria and little organelles called peroxisomes. This process of breaking down fat generates more ATP per carbon than sugars do. Now, sugar metabolism is very important, and sugar metabolism is occurring more readily than fatty acid metabolism is, partly because sugar can travel in the bloodstream more easily than fat and fatty acids can. The fatty acid metabolism works in a breakdown process that proceeds by a chopping off of two carbons at a time from a fatty acid. And you can see that happening in this process here. On the top, I have a schematic representation of a fatty acid, and I've marked the two carbon pieces that get chopped off. We see, first of all, the release of the fatty acid, and the fatty acid is broken between what are called the alpha carbon, as you can see here, and the beta carbon here. So in the numbering scheme that's here, that's between carbons numbers 2 and 3. So either term is commonly used. That breakdown process, as I said, releases a single acetyl-CoA, that's a two-carbon piece, and then continues along at two carbons at a time until the entire fatty acid has been broken down. Now, fatty acid oxidation is a multi-step process, like most metabolic pathways, but there has to be some processing of the fatty acids to get them ready for the oxidation. Fatty acids that start in the cytoplasm have to first be activated and then moved into the mitochondrion, but as we will see, that process is a little odd. The activation of a fatty acid begins in the cytoplasm, and this involves the attachment to the fatty acid of a molecule called coenzyme A, or as people more commonly say, CoA. This is an energy-requiring step, and you can see that ATP energy is needed to do this, and the product of this is not ADP, as we've seen many times before, but actually AMP. And that's a reflection of the fact that this is a pretty high-energy bond that's being created. The result of this action is a molecule called fatty acyl-CoA. Now, fatty acyl-CoA needs to get into the mitochondrion where the oxidation occurs, but there's a little complication with that. The acyl-CoA won't directly go into the mitochondrion. So the cell has wasted some energy, in some thought, by putting this CoA onto the acyl-CoA, and then we see it gets taken off. So in the next step of the process, starting in the cytoplasm on the left, we see that the acyl-CoA is combined with a molecule called carnitine to make an acyl-carnitine. Now, this step is essential for the movement of the acyl group into the mitochondrion, and the reason is the CoA just can't make that move across the lipid bilayer. I should also mention that we're looking at the mitochondrion here. So on the right side, where it says matrix, we're talking about the inside of the mitochondrion, and of course on the left side, where it says cytosol, we're talking about the cytoplasm of the cell. In between the two, you see the yellow and blue lines that are drawn there, and those relate to two layers of membrane covering the mitochondrion, the yellow one being what's called the outer layer and the blue one what's the inner layer. The blue one is very impermeable to a lot of substances, whereas the yellow one is fairly permeable. So you see the acyl-carnitine moving into what's called the intermembrane space, the space between the yellow and the blue lines, and then when it gets there, it encounters the yellow protein there that is a transfer protein that physically moves the acyl-carnitine into the mitochondrial matrix, as you see. Now, once it gets in the mitochondrion, then the reverse of all this process actually happens. The CoA that was floating around the mitochondrion is now attached to the acyl group, and the carnitine is released. The carnitine ultimately makes it back out into the cytoplasm, and the process continues. So what we've done here is what we describe as a shuttle. The shuttle has carried the acyl group from the cytoplasm into the mitochondrion. We have an acyl-CoA in there, and the acyl-CoA is the target for the oxidation. Beta-oxidation proceeds, now starting with that acyl-CoA. So, we see now the step-by-step process whereby a fatty acid is oxidized. The oxidation in this process is shown in the first step below. We see an enzyme called acyl-CoA dehydrogenase, and it does the very first reaction on that fatty acid. You can see that all the action in fatty acid oxidation occurs between carbons 2 and 3, or the alpha and beta, depending upon how you call it. The first oxidation is the removal of electrons and protons, and those are donated to FAD to make FADH2. The result of that oxidation creates a trans-bonded fatty acid called trans-delta-2-enoyl-CoA. That name isn't very commonly used, by the way. But the important thing is it's a trans fatty acid. And I note that it's not related to trans fat. Trans fat happens or is made for other reasons. This is a normal intermediate in fatty acid degradation. Trans fat is typically made by chemical treatment of food. Now, there are three forms of this enzyme. There's a form that works on long fatty acids, typically longer than about 20 or so, a form that works on medium-sized fatty acids between about 18 and 10 carbons, and then there's a form that works on short fatty acids, typically less than 10 carbons. Now, of note, the acyl-CoA dehydrogenase that works on the medium form of the acid is a form that is absent in infants who have died from sudden infant death syndrome. Now, it's not a cause-effect, but there appears to be a relationship between the absence of this enzyme and SIDS. Now, the FADH2 that was generated in this process can be taken into oxidative phosphorylation and used to make ATP. So we're seeing that these oxidative processes are used to generate energy that the cell can use for other purposes. Now, in the second reaction of fatty acid oxidation, we see that this trans intermediate gets a water added across it. This is a very common reaction in organic chemistry and is catalyzed by the enzyme enoyl-CoA hydratase. This enoyl-CoA hydratase creates a molecule that has a hydroxyl group on the beta carbon, or carbon number 3, and that hydroxyl group is in the L configuration, as you can see here. Now, this reaction is similar to a reaction that occurs in the citric acid cycle. In fact, this reaction and the next two reactions are very similar to citric acid cycle reactions. And this allows for an oxidation that will occur in the next step. So the second oxidation of fatty acid, fatty acyl-CoAs, occurs by the process that you can see here. On the bottom you see that we have the hydroxyl fatty acid that we created on the last step. And on this step, we see that that hydroxyl group is converted into a ketone. That oxidation is catalyzed by the enzyme that you see on the screen and causes production of NADH plus H plus, that is the transfer of electrons and protons as we have seen before. Now, this reaction is similar to the malate dehydrogenase reaction of the citric acid cycle. This reaction is preparing us for the final step in which we will actually cleave the fatty acid into two pieces. The NADH, of course, like the FADH2, can be used to generate ATP in oxidative phosphorylation. Now, in the last step of the process, we see the keto of acyl-CoA that was created in the last step of the process being broken into two pieces. So the bond between carbons 2 and 3, or the alpha and beta, as you can see here, is broken, and the product of that is an acyl-CoA that has been shortened by two carbons and an acetyl-CoA. Now, the acetyl-CoA itself can be targeted for additional oxidation in the citric acid cycle. If we look at the oxidation, for example, of the fatty acid palmitate, which has 16 carbons, the complete oxidation of that fatty acid can generate close to 140 ATPs. So fatty acids have a lot of energy stored within inside of them. Now, the thiolase enzyme that catalyzes this reaction is interesting because, obviously, it's catalyzing this breakdown, but also the reverse reaction of this creates an important intermediate if the acyl-CoA only has two carbons. So if we have an acyl-CoA that only has two carbons on the right side, then we can combine that with the acetyl-CoA. Well, an acyl-CoA that contains two carbons is also acetyl-CoA. Now, what thiolase does is it joins together two molecules of acetyl-CoA in the beginning of a process of the formation of important energy molecules known as ketone bodies.